While the presence of the Lord is so great, while the presence of the Lord is so great, overpowering, overshadowing everything, if you'll let the Holy Spirit, and if I'll let the Holy Spirit, it will take away every aggravating thing that you receive. Because that's in the flesh. But the Spirit of God is greater. Greater. Praise the name of the Lord. Greater. We have Brother Joel standing here.
Thank you.
Joel. And his nephew, Brandon Lyon, our student at Tabernacle Christian School, Kathy's son, Kathy Lyon's son, Joel's sister's son. He's in All Children's Hospital. He's a courageous young man.
Yes.
I saw him this afternoon, and Brother Bob Reynolds, whom we're happy to have, we prayed with him, and Kathy, and his fathers. We want to pray now as a church.
Amen.
This young man, 16 years old, has no future without God. Gives him that future. Medically speaking, he has multiple sclerosis, muscular dystrophy. He has MD, or muscular dystrophy. Anyone with any knowledge at all knows what that means. But God is greater, and God is able. So I'm going to rouse you out of your chair if you can stand with me. I want you to forget about every aggravating thing there is on this earth. And I want you to believe with me right now. For this is the place where we believe. This is the strong fortress of the Lord. The church is gathered together tonight. And there is power in the blood. And there is power in the name of Jesus. And there is power in the spoken word. I believe tonight we have all the ingredients assembled right here.
Amen.
Right here. And we come before our God, our high holy God. And we plead the blood tonight before our high holy God. And we lay line along with all the rest of the sick and the afflicted, every need there is and every human need there would be. We're going to lay it on the altar. We're going to believe God will see and hear the plea. Every single one of the church of the living God. For every need there is tonight in the house, every need there is, it doesn't matter what it is. Your need over there, your need back here, your need here, my need, our needs. We're going to believe God right now, because if you knew him like I know him, there's no doubt about what God will do, can do, and is going to do. Let's join together, one mind, one accord, right now, Church of the Living God. Let's go to him right now, everyone together, one mind, one accord, in the name of Jesus, we come right now. In Jesus' name, we call upon you, O God, to look down upon all children's hospital and to see this boy, this 16-year-old, this 16-year-old, this 16-year-old young man with his disease in his body. And we believe God is greater than the works of disease, the works of Satan, and the works of evil, and the works of the flesh. We believe that our God is greater tonight. We're embracing faith, and we believe every sick person here, every sick person not here, every afflicted one, we believe that you can see and understand and know, and we believe in the name of Jesus, power in the blood, power in the resurrection power, given in the redeeming name of God. And I'm sure it may placed on his spine, and tuberculosis was eating Brother Bob Reynolds, who shared with us on the weekend. And I hear, welcome here, Brother Bob. This man is so close to me in the ministry, so very close. And I want him to be at home, I want him to be at liberty. I want him to have God to have for him. He gave the testimony how that the handkerchief was anointed and placed on his spine when he was dying of tuberculosis.
Yeah.
As a young man, what were you, 8 years old or so? 8 years old, he was dying. They placed a handkerchief at his dear mother, and I knew his dear mother. I pastored his dear mother. They placed this handkerchief on the Lord. They gave it to him, placed it on his spine. And from the time that handkerchief touched his spine, tuberculosis split his body. And the spine began to heal. For tuberculosis had eaten his body, eaten his spine. And Von Reynolds is a well man today. Do I have to say, can someone pray?
Praise the Lord. Praise
God.
Yes, hallelujah.
Praise God. I'm going to give this handkerchief to you, Joel. And whomever, if you don't go there before I do, you can call me and tell me I'll take it. Promise you'll take it. Take this handkerchief. Place it there. His body. Praise our God.
Amen.
I believe. I believe. While we give our offering for the evening, let's continue to worship God. Don't break worship. Don't break worship. Just go and give your offering. We're going to believe God. Let's don't break worship. Let's continue to worship. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Thank you.
I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord.
Praise God.
Thank you, Jesus.
There's some good things, isn't there?
Yes.
I'm a very happy person in my soul tonight. I think that's appropriate that I should be.
Amen.
And it's very norm. There are some things that are abnormal, but there are some things normal.
Yeah.
If you have blood pressure and I have 204, that's abnormal. That top figure is abnormal. You don't want that 204 over 168. It's abnormal. There are normal things. And one of them, the normal, is for to go into the house of God and discover the wonders of God.
Yes.
Right. Amen.
Amen.
That's intriguing.
Yes.
I've always lived in a certain realm in my mind since I've been a Christian of the wonder of God. And the grace of God.
Yes.
And the beauty of God.
Amen.
And that has helped me to overcome the challenges of the abnormal part of self-life I encountered. What is that? When I became a Christian, anything that robbed me of my joy and just being saved, anything that robbed me of my certain knowledge that I would not lie in the pavement of life,
amen, brother,
and be run over by the horses,
no.
And I suddenly had a conqueror in me.
More than.
And I realized that early in my Christian life that I was not anymore the victim. But I became the victor. And that knowledge has been a life preserver to me, keeping me afloat in a sea of life. But I no longer was a victim. But I became a victor. And from the early days of my experience with Christ, I felt that resounding joy in my spirit. And even though that I was a victim as a child of the word depression, and it was in the genealogy of our family, and it was a terrible monster that devoured my precious mother's life, devoured the marriage she had with John L. Monroe Marwood, devoured the happiness of six children born to them. That one thing, depression, it means putting down. It means putting you down. And many people have it through genealogy, inheritance. Many people cultivate it through thinking. And the way they think, and the way they insist on thinking, they cultivate depression. But when I came to Christ, I was a victim of that. And that does not, let me state this. Victory in Christ does not mean that you're no longer a human being.
Amen.
Victory in Christ does not mean that you suddenly are angelic and cherubic wings. Being a Christian does not take away the fact that you need vitamin C.
Amen, brother.
And vitamin D. And B1, B12. Being a Christian does not remove you from the reality of life. But it gives you the tools to cope with life.
Yes.
It gives you the tools to deal with pessimism, vibration, those words that filter through the lenses of our mind, bathes our night's sleep, causes the pillow to be tossed and wrinkled. I have awakened some nights from my sleep and found my pillow twisted into a ball. For I was wrenching it like I was wrestling with a foe. If I had not had one thing, my experience with Christ.
That's right.
I said my experience with Christ. Not my fanaticism. People do enjoy fanaticism in religion, as they do in life. But my reality, I've been spending about a week, and God has been transforming my mind, leading me in chambers I've never been. I tell you, it's wonderful, the journey of God.
Amen.
It's wonderful, the journey of faith.
Yes.
It's exciting.
Yes.
It's exhilarating.
Yes.
It's challenging for God to get in your mind and your soul and your spirit. They're all connected together. They're in one bundle. The mind, the soul, the spirit, the heart. It's all in one bundle. God dissects it, but you can't. God takes it apart, but you're not able. But he knows the soul, he knows the spirit, he knows the heart. Knows the mind, knows all the parts. And I have had a challenge from God as a man, and then as a responsible man of God, to not let the elevator of my life go any further down. You know, it's a wonderful feeling when you step on an elevator and you push the button third floor, fourth floor, and you wait a moment. But then that's only a moment. And suddenly you feel that lift. Praise God, the elevator's working. But if you press that button, and you stand there, nothing happened. I'm not going in there. The elevator's not responding. All kind of things start happening to you. Is the elevator working? Am I trapped in the elevator? Is the elevator about to collapse? You have a load in there, several hundred pounds, maybe into the thousands. You wonder if the elevator is going to make it or not. But all of a sudden, there's that lift. And you feel that lift. I came into my worship center tonight. I came into the house of God on a Saturday night. And it became Saturday night alive. And I could feel it in my hands. And I could feel it in my feet. And I could feel it in my spirit. The elevator is going up. With all the pounds that's in it of human flesh, my flesh, your flesh, their flesh, our flesh, the power of the elevator is still working tonight. Praise our God. And that elevator, taking out of language like I'm using, that elevator is described in the book of Colossians. Is it Colossians 2, 3? If you then be risen with Christ, the elevator. If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things that are above. Seek those things that are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Friend of mine, to thy congregation, brother and sister, there is no human power. And there's thrills in life. I've never done skydiving, but my daughter has, and my granddaughter has. And they love it. Paula loves it. Alicia loves it. And I said, pull it. Aren't you afraid when you step out of that plane? I'm not, Daddy. It's the greatest thrill in the world. Because it isn't the falling. It's the sudden lift. Because if you kept falling, there'd be no thrill. And it would be a short trip down. But suddenly there is a lift. You realize I've got a safety. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
That's exhilarating. She said, that's such an exhilarating feeling. Just the bungee jump. She likes that. Plunging downward. It's not the plunge that excites you. It's suddenly the stop and the bounce and the kick back up. Did you know, as long as our church has the kick back up,
amen, brother,
the bungee fall is not going to destroy the church.
No.
Praise our God. And this church is fairly crowded tonight. But if the thrill stays in here, and we the living keep the thrill for the dead, for them to resurrect and enjoy the Christ that you know and I know, this house will become more crowded.
That's right, brother.
Because there is a thrill in serving God. Amen.
Amen.
I said there is a thrill in serving God. Amen. There is a power greater than flesh. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
The tomb is greater than even the womb.
Amen. Amen.
Because the womb delivers to death. But the tomb delivered to life. Praise our God. And the cross is still greater than the fall. Because the fall of Adam was the bungee fall. It was a skydive. But if any man be in Christ, there's the parachute. Praise God. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Then he can seek those things which are above. And behold, all things will become new. I want to go to the book of Acts, Rome. Would you go over there with me? Acts, the 9th chapter. And I'm going to look in on Paul the Apostle for a moment. And we often look in on him. And he doesn't mind it because he died. And he's with Christ, sleeping with Christ. So he isn't. He isn't embarrassed at all if we look in on him. But in the book of Acts, 9th chapter 9, and I feel tonight a change in the air.
Come on, Pastor.
Amen.
Dogs are wonderful.
Yes, they are.
Spell them the version you have got.
Yes, amen.
Just turned over here, and dogs are wonderful.
Yes, they are.
If you study them, they'll let you know what's going on around you.
That's right.
They'll let you know what's going on near you. I have a dog that can predict the weather changes ahead of Channel 9. Personally, they would hire him if they knew him. They would probably become the chief meteorologist there.
Amen.
When the weather is starting to change, as it is, and will be tomorrow, 4 days ago, Teddy put his nose up in the living room and began to... I said to Ethel, the weather's starting to change. Because a creature of God detected it. I feel a change in the air.
Amen, brother. Thank you.
You know, a church can only go on a certain road so long. Because the road runs out. Unless there is a continual change, a continual refreshing, the Bible speaks of the time of refreshing. It's good to think about all the memories we have of wherever we've come from and whatever church we were with and whatever religion we were involved in and whatever experience we had. But that will not do you any good right now.
That's it.
Just remembering yesterday. There has to be manna falling from the sky for today. Give us this day our daily bread. I don't know how many of you came here tonight needing daily bread, but I came here needing daily bread. Because since I saw you last, I've enjoyed life. I have 8 well and 2 well, and I have slept fairly well, and I have driven cars, and I've sniffed the wind, and I've enjoyed life. But frankly, I've also endured a lot of huff and guff of life. And you have too. But there is a safety net in me called the Holy Spirit. And I felt it tonight. It just simply came in here like the wind blowing in the upper room. It was again the upper room here for a few moments, a few seconds, for a few minutes when they were singing those songs of power and praise and joy. I wasn't just a preacher standing here. I was anointed and ignited with the Holy Ghost. I lifted my hands and, brother, I felt the glory of the Lord. Come in. Praise God. And I began to sing praises unto the Lord. My face changed. My countenance changed. Because I touched the hem of his garment. I'm sounding this to you as good advice as your pastor. It is time for a radical change in the church of the living God. What do you mean, Brother Marlowe? I mean a change in the vision of where we've been to where we're going. A change in how we're going to get to the place called heaven. A change that involves study and prayer and energy and vibration in your body, your mind, your spirit. A change that involves involvement in you as you go toward that mystical place called heaven in some people's eyes, not in mine. It's real. Change. I'm glad to see this change in the praise team. I'm glad to see this change in the orchestra. I'm glad to see seats that are filled tonight that were not filled a month ago. I'm glad to see this right here in the elders. I'm glad to see saints out here with their hands uplifted. And despite the huff and guff and stuff of life, you've overcome it. And it's more important for you tonight to praise the God of Israel and the God of Jacob and the God of Abraham than it is to nurse your feelings through this service. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah, my God. I'm not capable of preaching, but he is. I said, I'm not capable of preaching, but he is. I can't heal, but I know a man that can. I can't change you, but I know a man that can. I'm a human being, but he isn't. Praise the name of the Lord. And I defy Satan tonight. I stand and I rebuke the powers of Satan and of darkness. I say, move away and move out of the church and move away from the children of God, because we're on our road and our way to heaven. Despite the lumps and bumps and obstacles, I never again will preach a negative message. It's a change. I never again will dwell and harp on non-essentials. That's a change. I never again will waste my time trying to convince somebody when the Holy Spirit isn't. That's a change. I never again will argue and debate with anybody about this point A against that point B. That's over. Because the church can no longer quibble its way to heaven and quarrel its way to heaven. And the church can no longer debate who is right and who is wrong, because you'll never prove who's right and who's wrong. And you can spend the rest of your life trying to prove who's right and who's wrong, and you'll never do it. But let God prove all things, and you'll never man be alive. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, I'm telling you tonight, I feel victory. Will you put your hand on your forehead or your shoulders or somewhere, or however you place it, and say, I feel victory? Why, Brother Marlowe, do you do that? Because I want you to state a positive fact. Because while I'm telling you to do that, the enemy is trying to bring up some aggravation to persuade you it isn't time to get a blessing from God. But it is time to build the house of the Lord. It is time to proclaim Jesus lives. It is time to proclaim He's the resurrection. He's the life. He's the healer from drugs. He's the healer from prostitution. He can take away sin in any degree.
Amen.
Amen. It's time. Yeah. It's time. In the ninth chapter of Acts, praise God. I'm going to give time, brothers, to move out in God. But, and anybody can. Let me tell you something. In this church, the widow's cry is heard, and there are no aged here. We love every one of God's children. Amen. And we do not separate you into categories and say, he's too old, she's too young, they don't have enough money, they're not wearing the proper riches of clothing. I'm telling you all, you can get involved in Jesus Christ tonight.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Every one of you can be involved in the plan of salvation. Because you were involved, whether you like it or not, when you gave your life to Christ, it wasn't just you repenting of your sins and saying, I'm forgiven. From the moment you said, Lord, and you subjected yourself to Him, and you bowed your knees to bow, and you said, I'll serve you. From that moment, you got on the train.
Yes, sir.
And you may be in the fifth baggage car, and I'm in the sixth, but you're still on the train.
Amen, brother.
We're all on the same train.
Amen.
This train is bound for glory. Amen. I said, this train is bound for glory. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. I don't care what happened. I don't care what the church has done, or not done, or will do. This church, this plan of salvation, the cross, the blood, the resurrection, the coming of Jesus. It's bound, isn't it? Thank you. Praise our God. Bill's got that over there. Glory, train. Thank you for the sound today. Praise God. Amen. I like that. Amen. Hallelujah. This train. I don't know what baggage car you're in. I don't know what car you're in the train. But you got on the train. Somewhere in your life, you said, yes, Lord. You said, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Amen, amen.
The church cannot stay where it's
been. No.
Can't stay where it was last week. But I saw Wednesday night here when the man of God from Africa, used of God, he's no different than me, he's no different than you. He's a man of God. He has his gift, his calling. I don't idolize any man, any place. I don't idolize God used that man.
Yes, he did.
And when I saw the power of the word, not the power of the man.
The word.
Not the power of the man, but the power of the word. When that man that works with you, he works with you, Mike. I've been saying it for a while. Works with Michael. Joe. And I've never seen that in years.
No.
It's been years since I've seen the power. The power of the Word.
Yes,
ma'am. I've spent several years, in the last year, I'm telling you, I've seen preachers preach their lungs out. Their voice was ragged. Their larynx was almost ripped to pieces. Their vocal cords was in strings. And they couldn't move anybody to wiggle their right finger. I've seen that the last few years.
Amen, brother.
I've seen the church almost become stone cold. Not reacting. Not moved. Not a word. As though they were dead. But I've always said God's word will motivate you. God's word will move you. And I have been in services when not the music, not the song, but the word, the preaching, the power of that word, the power of a man of God gripping the sword. Praise God. Standing behind this holy place, it raised the crowd to their feet. A resurrection came in the church. People were baptized over again in the Holy Ghost. A new experience fell. All from the Word. But it's been years since I've seen that reaction. But Wednesday night, when this man was sitting right down here, and he's a new man, he isn't experienced in the church. He doesn't know the P's and Q's of the church. He doesn't know what the church is about. But the power of that Word. And he rose up right down here. And he was in that chair right there. And he rose up. And at the preaching of harvest, it's time for a harvest. It's time for you to labor. It's time for laborers. Jesus needs laborers. And that man couldn't stand it. The power of the word touched that man. I want to be in the harvest. I want to be a laborer. Did you notice it wasn't the church collectively that said that? But God touched a man that has heard the gospel only once or twice. And he rose up and said, I want to be. I got it. It demanded of me, my Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. And I cried out in my spirit, Lord, never again will I sit in a negative mood or manner. Never again will I preach a negative message, because there is too much power in the blood of Jesus Christ. There is too much power in the name of Jesus. There is too much power in the Holy Ghost for me to be a departure where the dead are there. Praise the name of the Lord. How many want to be convicted tonight? How many want to be converted tonight? How many want to be changed tonight?
Change me, Lord.
You can become dull of hearing and your emotions cut off. And your sensitivities end. And let me tell you what takes the place of those emotions and those sensitivity when they no longer respond to the gospel preacher and gospel singing and the word of God. You know what then takes hold of your emotions and your sensitivities? Sin. Sin pulls at you. The desire to fulfill it. The desire to give in to it. The desire to give over it. Because your house is vacant. And my house is vacant. But the devil, Satan, the carnal mind, the natural nature, the fallen, the bungee leap, whatever you want to say, cannot come in to a child of God that is enthused and filled up, praise God, with the anticipation that they are on their way to heaven. And they are going to see the face of God. And it's only a matter of time till they get through all the stuff and they hear the angels singing, welcome home, child. You made it. Praise God. Somebody Don't you feel that right now? I feel some angels around here tonight. I feel angels helping me to lift my hand. I feel angels telling me, go on, go on, go on. And there's something down inside of me telling me to go on.
Preach on, brother. Preach on. Lead the sheep.
Praise God. No, I wouldn't do it justice if I got in there now. Acts 9. It's amazing. I've been saying I'm going to Acts 9 for the last 35 minutes. I haven't got there yet. But I'm not going there. I thank God that I had me to say what I needed to say.
Amen, brother.
Praise God. You know, blessed is the preacher can watch the turn in the road that occurs. Know when he's going down. Praise our God.
Amen.
Praise our God. But I want the Lord to develop this church tonight. I want him to do that. But he'll do what he wants to do. But I'm going to ask a personal question to all of you. Do you know the time of the hour, the day we're living in? And do you know it's time for us to change paces, change movements, change moods, change everything about us? And let's don't let the church be an absorbing ink pad to absorb yesterday's problems. Christians have one great falling failure they deal with continually. They want to resurrect the weakest point they've ever had in their life. They want to go back to it again. They want to go back to their mistake, their weakness, their failure. They want to go back to their argument. They want to go back to what they did or didn't do. Friend, you can't.
No.
Whatever you've done or haven't done, it's said and done.
Come on, okay.
And the only thing you can do is say, Lord. Lord, into thy hands I commit all things. I want to ask you what Jesus did on the cross, the last thing he did. His life was over. The rebukes were over. The Pharisees were passed. The woman pressing his garment was through. The pool of Siloam was over. All of his preaching was through. And he was there on the cross. And he said, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said this, he gave up the ghost. The past was through, the present was there, and the resurrection was in the morning.
Yes, sir.
Praise our God.
Amen.
I encourage the church in Bradenton. You cannot change one dot or T or cross it over of one moment of yesterday. But tonight, if you'll recognize the motivating, exhilarating, thrilling dimension of the power of the Holy Ghost that's in this place right now, praise our God. And get your mind as high as you can get it right now. Lift your arms as high as they will go right now. Praise him as much as you can praise him right now. And get your mind off everything called yesterday and realize we are now living in the greatest day since Calvary. And there is a refreshing wind blowing in the mulberry tree. Praise the name of the Lord. And if I go back to yesterday, I will cry some. I will weep some. I will say I could have, I might have, I should have. But friend, I'm not going there. Because tonight I feel the wind in my wings. I'm soaring like the eagle. I should be. Praise God. I came here not to lift and to loathe tonight the honeycomb. I came here to put the honeycomb in my mouth. I came here not like a turkey on the ground to trot around and say, I wish I could fly like the eagle. But I came here to say, bless God, I can fly like the eagle because the Lord is my God and he is my Savior and he has saved me. And I don't doubt I'm saved. I know I'm saved. I know I'm redeemed. I know I'm forgiven. I know the blood has worked in my life. Well, praise God, I've got some of you off the ground. on and quivering. You're up above thermal level. Praise the name of the Lord. Come on up with me. Let's go up. Let's go up higher. Let's go higher. Moment with God is the greatest moment you'll ever spend. Hallelujah. I don't know if that's a Pentecostal church. Praise God. Let me tell you something right now, Mary. God is good to us. God, right now the bomb is wanting to explode in here. It's not the hydrogen bomb, it's not the A-bomb, it's the C-bomb. Christ is to explode all over this house tonight and let you know that you can walk, you can talk, you can run, you can leap. He's here. I want to say it while I'm preaching here. I got a telephone call and I want to address them. They're listening, about 30 people or so out in Sacramento, near Sacramento, California. About 1,000 are listening across the nation. I got a call from Sacramento this week. Brother Marlowe, we remember you. We met you in 1966 in Pilgrim Temple in Oakland, California. And we now are here without a pastor. And our pastor is dead. And went on. The church is no longer Pilgrim Temple. It's through in Oakland. But we have adopted the church in Braindead as our church. And we are with you every service. And when you preach, we are hanging on to every word you're saying. And right now, hello, folks out in Sacramento. May God bless you out there. Help the Holy Ghost fall in Sacramento. May it flow in California. May it flow over the nation. It's time for the Holy Ghost to get back in the church. Glory to God. Well, may God bless you in Sacramento. May God bless you in Canada.
Yes.
God is moving. God is stirring. And if this church will get the thermal waves of glory in your wings of eagles, we will rise above the yesterday and the sadness and the crippling and the sorrow and the victory and the anger, and we will touch the hem of his garment. Brother Dale, I feel it. Hallelujah. I feel a healing coming down your street into your house. Praise our God. Hallelujah. Anybody stand on your feet and shout for Jesus today. Lift your hands. Praise our God. Let's do what God wants us to do. Let's let the page turn. Let's let the change come. Let's let the church be the church.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless them, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I don't want to take away from anything that Brother Marlon said here tonight, but I thought this song that we're fixing to sing is definitely fitting for tonight, that Jesus was the answer. He will be the answer, and He is still the answer. In our dying world that we're living in today, He's still the answer. Some of the verse says that men have tried so hard to prove that God's not really real. Stephen Hawking, one of the most brilliant men out there, has proven so hard, has tried so hard to prove that God does not exist.
They tried so hard.
But I know He hasn't had the experience, Brother Mike, in Christ that you have had.
Come on.
That God is still real. God is still the answer. Jesus is still the answer. Amen.
Some men try so hard to prove that God's not really real, while others say they know for sure His love you cannot feel. But I know He's real within one day He cleansed and He made me whole. For Jesus is still the answer. For the love deep in your soul, Jesus is still the answer. For the time and age just roll, Jesus is still the answer. He's the answer for your soul. And though many of it say He doesn't fit with their philosophies, I know Jesus He's always been, and He always will be. Some men pretend that things of this world has brought them peace of mind. But with the dawning of each day, new thrills they try to find. Not until they meet the Prince of Peace can they ever hope to find release. And Jesus is still the answer for a world that's longing for peace. Jesus is still the answer. And though time and age roll, Jesus is still the answer. He's the answer for your soul. And though some may say he doesn't fit with their philosophy. I know Jesus is still the answer. He's always been, always been. Some men try so hard to prove that God's not really real, while others say they know for sure his love you cannot feel. But I know he's real within my soul, for one day he came and he made me whole.
Jesus is still the answer.
Jesus is here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. church's address on, so he had to get a book that he had in the truck, and give him right the church's address in this book. But also, I went to the laundromat today. And the guy at the laundromat, he has cancer. And he done lost so much weight. I don't know his name. But anyway, he lost so much weight. He said he got to have an operation to last in December. He said he got colon cancer. That's why he lost weight. He said the reason he got the colon cancer, he has been eating too much meat, too much red meat. And I asked him, I said, well, if you change your diet, maybe you, you know, maybe you get rid of the colon cancer. But I had three cards with the church's address on it. So I gave him one, but I didn't have my pocketbook with me tonight to get his other guy one. So, Elder Marlo, if you don't mind, could you give me some cards with the church's name and number on it? Please.
Please. I need Carrie, you have cards?
Yes, sir.
You sure, sister? I haven't made anyone else that wants witness cards. Catch them. Before Brother Terry left the Lord using I just felt a quickening of the spirit of mine. Sister Marilyn. Sister Marilyn. Activate yourself. You haven't sung a song in the church services. Activate that member.
That was good.
We have gifts and talents among us. They're a blessing to us. Sing for the Lord.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh my goodness. Lord, this is your day. Oh my God. I enjoyed the service this evening. I was anxious to get here tonight.
Yes.
God has been so good to me. Seems like I just get in a hurry now to come and be around the children of God. You know what? I don't care how old we get. We are still children of the Most High God. And I'm glad about it today. I don't know about you, but I'm glad about it that I'm a child of God. And because he lives, he can live also.
Praise the Lord.
Yes,
indeed.
Thank you. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow, because he lives, all my fears are gone, because I know he holds the future. And life is worth the living is just because he lives.
Sing it, girl.
And because he lives, oh, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all my fears are gone. Because I know, yes, I know, he holds my future. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the
joy he gives, above greater still. Oh, there's a calm assurance of this child can face uncertain days.
Thank you. Change!
heaven in. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Our God is good. When he just said, I get up there and they closed out the service, I said, did you know who you're talking to? Amen. My wife lets me know I'm not a good closer. Amen. Because something gets a hold of me. I get behind this pulpit. Something gets a hold of me. Hallelujah. Amen. I feel it in my bones. Hallelujah. I feel it all over me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Our God is good. I believe we're going to have a wonderful day tomorrow. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Amen. In Putty Gorda. Hallelujah. Over at the Bridge Church. Hallelujah. How many believe we're going to have a wonderful day? Yeah. Hallelujah. Oh, and what joy will the Lord bring to our lives? Hallelujah. Do thy work, O God. Hallelujah. Do thy work, O Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let you give our hands raised to the Lord and say, thank you, Lord. Thank you for your peace. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your overshadowing power. Go with us in our homes, on the highways, wherever we go, Lord, and bring us back together so we can draw closer one to another under thee, Lord.
There's dinner, Brother Harrison, in the dining room tomorrow. And there it is on the board.
Yes.
Everybody participate, make it a great dinner.
Yes.
I want to thank the sisters and their cleaning table.
Yes.
Working in the dining room. Appreciate the people cleaning the sanctuary.
Yes.
Your sisters, Gina, here heading it up. Sunday, one's labor here every day. One's coming in, others that work with them, whatever, whoever you are, all of you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Amen.
I'll have a great day, as you said.
Amen. We're going to have a great day.
Bring on the dining room. Look on that screen.
Amen.
Bring it.
Amen.
Eat
come.
In the dining room.
Amen. Roll your
praise
sleeves
God.
Up. Be a part of what's going on.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The Lord will bless you for it. He'll bless you for it. Amen. For everything that you did. Amen. Let's remain or draw closer together.